Hello everyone and welcome to the series PIB 24/7. I'm your mentor Manish Mishra and in this session we'll discuss 5 more MCQs from the PIB news. I hope you guys are going good and using this golden opportunity of lockdown to study very hard. So ye bahut acha time hai aap logo ke paas ki ghar pe baithe aur bahut zyada padhai kare. Alright, so let's begin with the session. So first question for today is, under the public distribution system, a centrally sponsored pilot scheme has been approved to distribute fortified rice in 15 districts for a period of 3 years beginning 2019-20, which is financial year 20, with a total budget outlay of Rs. 174.64 crores. What is the main objective of the scheme? So guys, the name of this scheme is fortification of rice. Fortification of rice and its distribution through public distribution system. Okay, fortification of rice and its distribution through public distribution system is the name of the scheme. This scheme has been approved from the financial year 2020 with a total budget outlay of 174.64 crore. The aim of this scheme is to curb malnutrition, and to enhance the nutritional security of the citizens of India. Okay, the aim of this scheme is to curb the malnutrition and to enhance the nutritional security of the citizens of India. All right, and this scheme is a part of Poshan Abhiyan. Okay, you might heard of Poshan Abhiyan. This scheme is a part of Poshan Abhiyan, which is a flagship program of Ministry of Women and Child Development, headed by Smriti Irani. Now, the funding pattern under this scheme is that this scheme is funded by Government of India in the ratio of 90:10 in northeastern hilly and island states, and in the rest of the state the ratio is 75:25. Acha, ab fortified rice kya hota hai? Fortified rice is that rice in which some micronutrients are added, and under this scheme 3 micronutrients are to be added in the rice, which are iron, vitamin B12 and folic acid in the ratio 1:100. So fortified rice kya hota hai? Fortified rice wo rice hai jiske andar kuch micronutrients ko add karke uski nutritional values ko enhance kiya jata hai, uski nutritional values ko badhaya jata hai. To aise rice ko hum kya bolte hai? Fortified rice. And is scheme mein फोर्टिफिकेशन के लिए हम 3 चीजें मिला रहे हैं और वो कौन सी हैं? आयरन, विटामिन B12 एंड फॉलिक एसिड इन द रेशियो ऑफ 1:100. ऑलराइट, एंड दिस स्कीम फोकसेस ऑन 15 डिस्ट्रिक्ट्स, प्रेफरेबली 1 डिस्ट्रिक्ट पर स्टेट, एंड आउट ऑफ दी स्टेट्स महाराष्ट्र एंड गुजरात हैव ऑलरेडी स्टार्टेड डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन ऑफ फोर्टिफाइड राइस फ्रॉम फेब्रवरी 2020. ऑलराइट, नाउ द क्वेश्चन इज, वॉट इज द मेन ऑब्जेक्टिव ऑफ द स्कीम? सो द मेन ऑब्जेक्टिव ऑफ द स्कीम इज B, to curb malnutrition. I hope this scheme is clear. Fortification of rice and its distribution under public distribution system, which aimed at curbing malnutrition and to enhance the nutritional security of the citizens of India. It is a part of Poshan Abhiyan, which is a flagship program of Ministry of Women and Child Development, and the funding ratio is 90:10 for northeastern hilly and island state and 75:25 for the rest of the state. And fortified rice is that rice in which some micronutrients are added, and under this scheme 3 micronutrients are to be added, which are iron, vitamin B12 and folic acid in a ratio of 1:100. Next question is, the government is implementing amended technology upgradation fund scheme ATUFS, a credit linked capital investment subsidy scheme during 2016 to 2022 with an outlay of 17,822 crores. It aims to catalyze capital investments for technology upgradation and modernization of the dash industry. So guys, this amended technology upgradation fund ATUFS, amended technology upgradation fund scheme, has been launched for textile sector for augmentation of investment, productivity, quality, employment in the textile industry. So this ATUFS has been launched for textile industry for augmentation of various things like investment, productivity or quality, employment and etc. And it also aims to catalyze capital investments for technology upgradation and modernization of the textile industry. So the answer to this question is textile industry. Now there are three main provisions under this scheme, which are: number one is zero effect and zero defect. What does it mean? Zero effect and zero defect ka jo slogan tha, that was given by Prime Minister Narendra Modi, and this stands for production mechanisms. Though we have to use those production mechanisms which have no defect, and we have to use those production processes which have zero adverse environmental effects. Alright, so let me repeat this. Zero effect and zero defect ka kya matlab hai? Zero effect and zero defect ka matlab hai ki hame un production mechanisms ko use karna hai jahan pe koi defect na ho, aur hame un production processes ka istemal karna hai jahan pe environmental ke effects jo hai wo zero ho. Alright, next is import substitution. Import substitution is a policy which encourages the production in the domestic country, in the domestic market, rather than importing the product from the foreign countries. Like, to import substitution kya hai? Ki import substitution encourage karta hai kisko? Domestic production ko, rather than ki hum import ke upar dependent ho kisi ek particular product ke liye. Alright, and next is capital investment subsidy, under which manufacturers are entitled for reimbursement of capital investment subsidy under this scheme. And next is National Technical Textile Mission with an outlay of 1480 crore was also approved to improve the global status of India in technical textile sector. So I hope this question is clear now. You have to remember these three provisions of the scheme. One is zero effect and zero defect, which means we have to use those production mechanisms which have no defect, and those processes which have zero adverse environmental effects. Next is import substitution, which encourages the production in domestic market. And next is capital investment subsidy, under which manufacturers will be entitled for reimbursement of subsidies. Alright. Next question is, government has notified an order under the Essential Commodities Act to declare masks and hand sanitizers as essential commodities up to 30th June 2020 by amending the schedule of the Essential Commodities Act. What is not correct about the Essential Commodities Act? So let us discuss about this act. So guys, this act was enacted in 1955. Okay, and why this act was launched? This act was launched to ensure the easy availability of essential commodities to common consumers and to protect them from black marketing. Okay, let me repeat this. This act was launched to ensure the easy availability of essential commodities to common consumers and to protect those essential commodities from the black marketing. Now government can, under this act, can regulate or prohibit the production, supply, distribution. Let me write this. Production, supply, distribution and sale. Okay, so government can regulate or prohibit the production, supply, distribution and sale of any commodity if the government thinks necessary that it is necessary to maintain or increase or decrease the supply of that particular commodity. So government jo hai wo kisi bhi commodity ka production, supply, distribution ya sale ko regulate kar sakta hai, prohibit kar sakta hai, agar government ko lagta hai ki us particular product ki production ko badhana, kam karna ya regulate karna zaruri hai. Now there is a long list of the items which are included under the Essential Commodities Act, which includes some commodities like drugs, fertilizers, pulses and edible oils and petroleum and petroleum products. Now center government can also include new commodities whenever the need arises and also take them off the list once the situation improves. Now here one thing is important, that the inclusion of new commodities and exclusion of that particular commodity has been done by the central government, but the enforcement of this act lies with the state government and the UT administration in case of UT. Right? The enforcement of this act lies with the state governments and the UT administration. Now recently government has brought masks and hand sanitizers under the Essential Commodities Act, which are the key products for preventing the spread of COVID-19 infection. So अंडर द रिसेंट चेंजेस व्हाट गवर्नमेंट हैज डन इज दैट जो टू प्लाई मास्क होगा वो 8 रुपए से ज्यादा पे नहीं बिकेगा. द टू प्लाई मास्क कैन नॉट बी सोल्ड अबव ₹8 एंड थ्री प्लाई सर्जिकल मास्क कैन नॉट बी सोल्ड अबव ₹10 एंड अ बॉटल ऑफ 200 ml ऑफ हैंड सैनिटाइजर कैन नॉट बी सोल्ड अबव ₹100. ओके, 100 रुपए से ज्यादा 200 ml का हैंड सैनिटाइजर का बॉटल नहीं बिकेगा. 2 ply mask 8 रुपए से ज्यादा का नहीं बिकेगा एंड 3 ply surgical mask 10 रुपए से ज्यादा का नहीं बिकेगा. राइट, एंड अंडर द एसेंशियल कमोडिटीज एक्ट देर इज द प्रोविजन ऑफ इम्प्रिजनमेंट ऑफ अप टू 7 years और फाइन और बोथ फॉर द वायलेटर्स. एंड अंडर द PIBMSEC एक्ट विच स्टैंड्स फॉर प्रिवेंशन ऑफ ब्लैक मार्केटिंग एंड मेंटेनेंस ऑफ सप्लाईज ऑफ एसेंशियल कमोडिटीज. लेट मी रिपीट दिस, प्रिवेंशन ऑफ ब्लैक मार्केटिंग एंड मेंटेनेंस ऑफ सप्लाईज ऑफ एसेंशियल कमोडिटीज एक्ट. This act was enacted in 1980. Prevention of black marketing and maintenance of supplies of essential commodities act 1980. Under this act, there is a provision of retention of maximum 6 months for the violators. Okay. So now let's come to the question. We have to identify the incorrect statement about the essential commodities act. So first option is the ECA was enacted way back in 1957. No, the ECA was enacted in 1955. So therefore option A is the correct answer. So next question is, some differences are given below between the two schemes, Pradhan Mantri Kisan Samman Nidhi PM Kisan and Pradhan Mantri Kisan Mandhan Yojana, which are launched in 2019. Which statement is are not correct among the following? So now हम इनके डिफरेंसेस के बारे में देख लेते हैं. गाइस, बोथ द स्कीम्स आर लॉन्च बाय मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ एग्रीकल्चर एंड फार्मर्स वेलफेयर. दिस इज अ इनकम अश्योरेंस स्कीम एंड दिस इज अ सोशल सिक्योरिटी स्कीम टू स्मॉल एंड मार्जिनल फार्मर्स. ओके, अंडर द स्कीम ₹6,000 इन 3 installments आर प्रोवाइडेड टू ऑल द फार्मर्स ऑफ इंडिया. इससे पहले ये जो लिमिट थी ये थी 2 hectare लैंड की. जिनके पास 2 hectare लैंड से कम है उनको ये 6,000 मिलेंगे, लेकिन अब ये 2 hectare की लिमिट हटा दी गई है. नाउ हर फार्मर को irrespective of their land ₹6,000 per year diye jayenge. And under this scheme a fixed minimum pension of ₹3,000 is provided on attainment of 60 years. Now there is no age limit under PM Kisan Yojana, while under Pradhan Mantri Kisan Mandhan Yojana there is a entry age of 80 to 40 years. There is no contribution from the farmer side under PM Kisan, and while under Pradhan Mantri Kisan Mandhan Yojana there is a contribution of ₹55 to ₹200 that depending on the age when the farmer enters the scheme. In the 2019-20 the budget allocation for PM Kisan is 75,000 crore, while under PM Kisan Mandhan Yojana it is 900 crore. So these are some differences between the two schemes. Now let's come to the question. PM Kisan is launched by Ministry of Agriculture and Farmer Welfare, while PM Kisan Mandhan Yojana is launched by Ministry of Personnel, Public Grievances and Pensions. No, both the schemes are launched by Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare. So first option is incorrect. Next is PM Kisan Mandhan Yojana is an agricultural income insurance scheme, while PM Kisan is a social security scheme. नहीं, ये उल्टा गिवन है. PM Kisan is an agricultural income insurance scheme, while PM किसान मानधन योजना इज अ सोशल सिक्योरिटी स्कीम. देयरफॉर ये ऑप्शन भी गलत है. नेक्स्ट इज बजट एलोकेशन इन 2019-20 बजट फॉर पीएम किसान इज ₹75,000 crore, वाइल फॉर प्रधानमंत्री किसान मानधन योजना इट इज ₹900 crore. ये बिल्कुल सही है. एज इज नो बार टू अवेल द बेनिफिट ऑफ पीएम किसान, वाइल एंट्री एज इन इज 18 to 40 years फॉर पीएम KMY. Yes, this is also correct. And PMKMY is a contributory scheme, while PM Kisan seeks no contribution. Yes, इसमें 18 से 40 तक की एज में एंट्री की जा सकती है और ₹55 से लेके इसके अंदर कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन प्रोवाइड करना पड़ता है. सो दिस इज ऑल्सो करेक्ट. देर फोर द करेक्ट आंसर इज B1 and 2 ओनली, बिकॉज वी हैव टू आइडेंटिफाई द इनकरेक्ट स्टेटमेंट. नाउ लास्ट क्वेश्चन फॉर टूडे इज फॉर रिड्यूसिंग रिलायंस ऑन इम्पोर्ट्स and promoting exports of defense and aerospace related items to other countries, it has been decided to set up 2 defense industrial corridors in the country. Which are the 2 states selected to set up the defense corridor? So what are the defense industrial corridors? Defense industrial corridors will facilitate the development of internationally कॉम्पिटिटिव एंटरप्राइजेस टू मैन्युफैक्चर डिफेंस इक्विपमेंट, ताकि इंडिया जो है वो स्ट्रेटेजिकली इंडिपेंडेंट हो जाए अपनी डिफेंस मैन्युफैक्चरिंग को लेके। डिफेंस इंडस्ट्रियल कॉरिडोर जो है इंडिया को अपनी डिफेंस मैन्युफैक्चरिंग में स्ट्रेटेजिकली इंडिपेंडेंट बनाने के लिए एक स्टेप है बाय द गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया। और इसमें होगा क्या, जितने भी डिफेंस मैन्युफैक्चरिंग यूनिट हैं उनको आपस में कनेक्ट कर दिया जाएगा, ताकि जो एक डिफेंस इकोसिस्टम है, एक बेहतर डिफेंस इकोसिस्टम है, उसको क्रिएट किया जा सके। एंड द टू स्टेट्स विच आर सिलेक्टेड टू सेटअप द डिफेंस कॉरिडोर्स आर उत्तर प्रदेश एंड तमिलनाडु। एंड इन उत्तर प्रदेश देर आर देर आर सिक्स नोड्स विच आर आगरा, अलीगढ़, चित्रकूट, झांसी, कानपुर एंड लखनऊ। एंड इन तमिलनाडु देर आर फाइव नोड्स विच आर चेन्नई, कोयम्बटूर, होसूर, सलेम एंड तिरुचिरापल्ली। एंड देर इज नो प्रपोजल टू सेटअप मोर डिफेंस इंडस्ट्रियल कॉरिडोर इन द कंट्री। तो अभी दो ही रहेंगे, उत्तर प्रदेश और तमिलनाडु। सो गाइस, दिस वॉज द फिफ्थ क्वेश्चन एंड दैट्स इट विद द सेशन टूडे। आई होप यू लाइक द सेशन। फॉर मोर अपडेट्स डू सब्सक्राइब आवर चैनल एंड प्रेस द बेल आइकन। मिलते हैं नेक्स्ट सेशन में। गुड बाय, टेक केयर, गॉड ब्लेस।